Right now we're going to take a look at the fishing setup and just some of the things that I've done to make this boat more efficient at fishing. Now, one of the most important things, of course, is really just in the layout. The room we've got, two people can pass by each other around the central bin, because when you're fishing, you don't want to be squeezing through areas. Same goes for the back here, plenty of room when you're in the bait station. So nice and clean and open. With the design of the boat, we've pushed the transom boxes right back. The Evinrude E-Tex and their clean rigging have allowed me to get right into the corners. With my ladder, I haven't gone for a bolt-on ladder or anything with rungs that a line can catch on or hook on. Even my cleats, pop-in cleats. So everything is nice and smooth and clean. By being able to work right into the corner when you're hooked up to a fish, gives you a nice, clean arc of line. Another big thing for me is obviously having access to everything I need when I need it. Now, I've got plenty of tackle stored in drawers inside. All of the stuff I need at the ready is in this tackle drawer. And so I've got tools immediately at the front. Cutters, you're using these all the time. These are heavy duty gardening shears, and they just live in one of these knife slots because I'm always grabbing them. And I've just got all the basic stuff, insulation tape, knife sharpeners, split ring pliers. Having my leaders all set out, I can just pull out the length of leader that I want, snip it off, and right in front of me is box with circle hooks, box with J hooks. Just having everything you need, where you know it's going to be, when you want it, all set out in front of you just like this, so I can grab it, I can rig up, I can tie a bait on. If I'm doing a particular style of fishing, let's say I've got a box of slow jigs here, I can just pull it out, that sits there, everyone's got access to it. Got things like rigging twine, bait flies, everything, all set out, easy to grab. And when I do want to rig baits, I've got my rigging twine. Again, pull out the length of rigging gear that I want, cut it off, I select my needle that I want that stays right here, I can rig all my baits up. Again, everything's at hand. Adding just a bit of this OctiGrip on the top and also on the bottom stops your nice sharp knife blade rubbing against aluminium. Just basic stuff like that, it's going to dull your knife. That, and when boats are going along, you don't want to be listening to a knife rattling, so it just keeps everything nice and snug. These drink holders, yes, they get drinks in them occasionally, because of course when you're filleting, it's pretty much compulsory that you have to have a beer in order to be able to do it properly. But I mainly use this one here for rubber bands, because I'm using them all the time, particularly when I'm game fishing. And this side over here, I've got my venting needles, because of course when you're releasing fish that have come up from the depths, you just need to give them a poke with that. So everything nice and on hand. Moving over to the live bait tank, I've got a stock standard rule pump that pumps water through my live bait tank. You don't need a whole lot of flow for your live bait tank. You just need good clean water, and you need to make sure that your outflow isn't too low and it isn't too big. We've got slots in the top here. You don't want them so big that a bait can get jammed in it. And you'll see that I've just drilled additional holes, and that's because my starting position for my drain is having not enough water getting out. And so it was at the point where the water was squirting out under the lid when I had water coming in. So I've just drilled one hole at a time until I've got the right amount of flow, that I've got enough pressure in that tank so the baits aren't getting slopped around with low water level and it's not gushing out the top and running back into the boat. Two Turner tubes, they've each got an individual pump, but I've got a real simple plumbing system that I can flick a valve and I can have one pump feeding two tubes if I don't need a lot of flow, or I can have one on each, or I can even divert water from one of my Turner tube pumps should I have the live bait tank pump fail. Down here I've got an auxiliary tap with a hose, so I've got even got a backup for my washdown, or I could run that hose into my live bait tank. So it's just about keeping your baits good, because I'm a bait guy and my baits need to be looked after. For tuna tubes, you don't need a whole lot of flow. I think that's a fallacy. You just need good, clean water. So with the additional pod that we had built into the hull, which is at the lowest point for the transducers to give us transducer performance, behind the transducers, so we don't disturb any water going over them, we've put two scoops at the deepest point. That way, they're not getting air bubbles. It's the air bubbles coming up through your tuna tubes that are going to kill your tuna or shorten their life. So good, clean water. Good constant flow, you don't need huge amounts of pressure. Now, speaking of bait fishing, this old bits of butanol that I've salvaged off of an old roofing job. So whenever I'm bait fishing, I'm chucking these down mats on the ground, quite simply because I've got a new boat and I don't like scrubbing that much. So when you're landing, say, big harpooka, even big tuna, actually, I'll better than wet the deck. This is what I brought this for, the tuna mat.
That's unreal.
Yeah, bro.
You can come in, drop them on this, you can break them down on the spot, and then you're not worried about constantly hosing and scrubbing it off the deck. You can pick them back up with all the guts and scales and nastiness on them over the side, give them a dip, roll them back up under the combing. Now, if there's one key fishing area on the boat, well, for me in particular, being the skipper, it's right here. So when I've found my spot, I tend to not anchor typically. I'll use my Sabiki mode or iDock or even these throttles here to hold myself on the spot. And I can see the plotter, or even better, we can add the TV, which hooks into the plotter, and now everyone in the cockpit can see exactly what's happening below us. They can even watch their jig or lure going down. I can make adjustments on the throttles here to line up that jig dropping with the fish that's below us, or even use the iDock. And I've got these rod holders here which can rotate around. Quite often I'll have the bent butt in there with a live bait. I can swing it around with one hand, and everything is all within arm's reach of me here, whether it be the throttles that I'm driving from, the iDock, or if it's not in arm's reach, I've got my Furuno remote, and I can make adjustments and drive the boat from here with the remote or anywhere that I happen to be in the boat. And particularly when you're backing up, which is what you're most often doing when you're fishing, just to hold the back of the boat into the wind, a lot of boats will really struggle with that. And that's because of the design of the transom. Most boats will have a swim step or a platform around the outboards. And as you back into the sea, the boat goes down, comes up, flicks water in the air, the wind's coming this way, you get spray everywhere. That's terrible for anyone, but it's worse for us with cameras when you're backing into a sea and there's spray coming over the back. The Stabycraft Game Chaser transom just eliminates that. I can go out fishing, be driving from here, backing up into a sea to hold us over fish, and up to 20 knots, and there is not water coming in over the back. When we are fighting a fish, quite often this is the position. We're chasing forward like that, but with the iDock now, we can really rip over sideways or rip around backwards, and this thing just backs up unbelievably well, particularly with the grip I'm getting from the twin engines and those RX3 props. Now, of course, I do a lot of game fishing, so outriggers are key, and I've got some pretty big badass outriggers. I've got the Ocean Blue outriggers. They're done in the carbon fibre styling as well to match the boat, and they're 17 footers, telescopics. And to put them out to fish, there you go, I'm just done. So I'm not lifting outriggers, I'm not untangling halyards and trying to get them set up. I'm fishing now, ready to go. My rubber band goes directly onto that if I'm using my tagline, or I'm just sliding down and clipping into my black clip and sliding it to the top of the halyard. If we do that again, because it seems unbelievable, steaming position. I drive around, the riggers stay up quite happily all day, every day, wherever I'm going, and when I'm ready to start trolling, clicked, locked into position, ready to go. Rod sitting in the rod holder here, grab my rubber band, straight onto here with a slip knot, up it goes, and I'm fishing. Now you can have a look at a detailed setup of outriggers at ultimatefishing.tv and how to fish different methods for different type of marlin, and when you're experiencing different sorts of bites, whether you're using a drop back from a Blacks clip, a tag line, which is preferable for your tuna and blue marlin. You can check all of that out and exactly how we set it up. But one of the critical things I'm going to show you right now is this point here, this stainless steel eyelet that I've put on to clip the outrigger halyards to. There is literally only one place on the boat that it can go. Now, I've chosen to go roof mounted and above the head, for two reasons. It gives me extra height. If I'm starting from the roof rather than the combing, it means I can get more spread because I don't have to have my outriggers angled up. The next thing is, I've got a walk around. Why on earth would I have an outrigger attached to the side of the boat or the combing? All this is nice and clear, so you can be hooked up and come up here completely unobstructed. The outrigger's nice and out of the way. But in order to have it tight when it's in the back position and tight and ready to fish when it's in the out position, you need to spend a little bit of time experimenting, getting the tension and moving it up and down the side of the boat, holding it when it's in a good tight position in the out position, swiveling it around and ensuring it's still tight in the back. If it's loose at the back, you've got to move forward. And if it's loose when it's out, you've got to move aft. And there's one sweet spot, literally within 10 mil. As soon as I found that, I marked the point, drill my hole, put in my stainless eyelet, because that's tight and ready to fish. And I can't stress enough the importance of having nice, tight, stiff outriggers. That's what I love about these Ocean Blue outriggers. Bit of time to get them set up perfectly will save you loads of time out on the water. Well, that's just some of the detail that's gone from my fishing experience into a boat just to make it better and more efficient. But of course, a lot of it has to do with finding the fish, which we're going to cover off in our marine electronics review, which is on ultimatefishing.tv. And of course, all of the results and action from the fish that we're going to be catching on this boat, as well as the detail on the baits and rigs that we use, they're all available free right now at ultimatefishing.tv.